that you were going to say something piquant there. It's a great pleasure to be here, and thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you for sticking around to listen to you. Listen to me. I realize I'm the last thing between you and a beer, so... when Tom first contacted me, it seems to be a common thread for many of the speakers. First of all, he said, talk about what you like. Okay. And then he said, no, talk about restoration. I said, no, I don't want to talk about restoration. So I'm actually going to talk a bit about the long-term work I've been doing in California, and then talk a bit about restoration, just to keep it going. So what I would love to talk about, first of all, is things about surfacing grasslands, introduce a long-term experiment I've been doing in Jasper Ridge, talk a little bit about grassland restoration and management, and then finally talk about goals and approaches for restoration in general. I'm a true alien. I came from Scotland originally, and I now live in Australia, West Australia. So where I live is here, and we've heard a little bit about this already. It's another of these biodiversity hotspots. It's a wonderful place for flora and fauna. I could talk for hours about all this stuff, and I can't, but we'll get to hear them, so that's no problem. Amazing vegetation types. When I first went there, I thought I'd arrived on a different planet, never mind a different continent. I could almost repeat Carlos' talk for what's happened in Western Australia compared with what's happened in California. We have all the same issues. We have incipient climate change, we have urbanization, we have dramatic habitat reduction, adding a few more as well, salinization and so on. And we're actually a bit ahead of you in terms of climate change, because we've already had a 20% reduction of rainfall since the 1970s. And so it's real. It's no longer something that's going to happen in the future. We're actually experiencing it. I work at the University of Western Australia, and coincidentally, we also had our 100th anniversary this year. This was the 100th anniversary celebration of the big light for the central building of the university. We also had a centenary plant, so we had a centenary hickia. So we'd like to see that at the university. Plus, take notice of our amazing biodiversity. Not many of the rest of the population of Western Australia do, but our university does. As I said, I could talk for a very long time about Australia. I've chosen to speak about California because, in some ways, it's almost become a second or third home, if you like. And the first time I came to California was in 1976-77, where I came across to do a master's at the University of California, Santa Barbara. At the same time, Tom Parker was there as a grad student. I tried very hard to find a photo of Tom as a grad student at UCSB, but I couldn't. So this is a picture of me on a field trip with some other people there, grad students and undergraduates, on what probably was the most influential course I've ever taken in my life. This was John Miller's Vegetation and Flora of California, Flora and Vegetation of California, an amazingly tall course. And we really need stuff like this going on if we want to do what Carla was talking about, getting people engaged in this stuff. John very successfully showed the California flora as this amazingly diverse, beautiful, interesting stuff. And he took us off on wonderful field trips up the coast and across the Sierras and down the deserts and things like that. An amazing way to be introduced to the flora, California flora. From there, I went back to Scotland to do a PhD, but I liked California so much that I tried my best to come back. I did a postdoc at Stanford in the early 80s, and I've since been coming back to Stanford every year. I'll tell you why in a little while. I did find a picture of Tom Parker on one of my students. And this is the Winnie group. I think it's about 1990. Can you remember when it was? Talk about that.
A little earlier.
The characteristic of the Winnie group is that Hal Winnie is absent. he seems to travel around the world, and he comes up this very seldom, even to this day. Hal just our date last year. The reason I went to California was to I ended up studying 17 grasslands, and this is the 17 grasslands up at Jasper Ridge. This yellow area here is where the serpentine is, and the surrounding grasslands are all covered with the nasty Mediterranean grasses we've been talking about, Bromeseas, Avenas, and so on. The nice thing about where I work on Jasper Ridge is that it's about 15 minutes away from Stanford, and it's a wonderful place to do really detailed biological work, because you can go up, do some work in the morning, come back down for lunch, come back up again. It's just a spectacular place. And of course, Stanford's a wonderful place too. I know this is heresy here talking in Berkeley, but we won the big game this year. Okay, so two influential characters in Stanford, Paul Ehrlich and Hal Mooney, who I've had the pleasure of interacting with over many years. They were often quite wrong why I was there. They knew I turned up every spring, but they weren't entirely sure. Dynamics has to start from scratch again as plants in the bay. So the gopher has produced mounds like this about 20 centimetres across, and they result in a very heterogeneous, patchy type of vegetation. And so from my postdoc, I looked at the dynamics behind that, the secret spiritual of the gopher mounds and survival and all that kind of stuff, which was really fascinating. About different things happening with different species. I won't go into the details here because I want to move on to the other stuff, but that was a kind of small scale detailed study I did in my postdoc. These are some sea traps on the gopher mounds, and this was me when I had more air in my sense. Sea dispersal So, because I was looking at gopher mounds, I decided that the best way to figure out the effects, as well as this descriptive stuff of looking at gopher mounds themselves, was actually to try and exclude gophers from some of the area and see what happened to the grassland without that disturbance. So, we decided to try and do that, plus added a treatment which removed the buffer and herbivores as well, which we assumed at the time were mostly rabbits and maybe the odd deer. So we had control treatments where we didn't do anything. We had a gopher exposure where we dug the pits in the bedrock, which fortunately the desperate wasn't very deep, with the idea that we'd keep gophers out. And then we had buffer exposures as well, where obviously there's nothing to hold by we wanted to keep rats. Okay, so, I mean, that gives you a good perspective, I think, probably better than any other kind of what happens in this number. Number one, it's incredibly variable from year to year. Number two, it's incredibly variable spatially. This is just one of the sensor control plots, and you can see even the bunch grasses, which are perennial, they sort of come and go and move around and so on. And the abundances of different species vary greatly from year to year. The overall density is very year to year too. Just to show you some data, this is a paper that came out a few years ago now, on the first 20 years of this data set, with a few of the dominant species. I think these are all the same name at the moment. The main thing you see is that overall the treatments are, maybe have small effects, but the big effect is the interannual variation in abundances. And so that sort of changes the focus away from the original aspects of the experiment, especially since we couldn't keep over for very long. So looking at this variation with annual rainfall variation. So we had, these are a couple of the dominants, Plantago and Lastenia. And as you can see, they have very large variations from year to year. But there's also a whole bunch of other things happening in the grassland, like this microsporous year, where for the first part of the study, it was really a very incidental element of the overall vegetation. But suddenly, at the end of the 80s, it shot up to be almost the dominant species, and then disappeared again, and it's since come up again. So we have some species that hang around with very slightly abundance, and there's others that are really huge variations in their overall abundance. So a lot of that is related to rainfall variation, just overall amount of rainfall. But now we're getting into looking at what the effects of timing of the start of the rainfall, the overall amounts, and then the rainfall period, and so on. We've now got 30 years of data, and we're starting to analyze that. It's probably taken up until right now to have enough years to actually start teasing out some of these complex interactions. As you can see from the pictures, it's very variable through time, and it's also very, very variable spatially. And the gopher disturbance has an effect on top of that. So actually figuring out what the actual triggers for each of these changes are is really quite complicated. Just a word about taxonomy. We heard some taxonomy discussions this morning. This is the table of the main species that were divided by plots. The highlighted ones are the ones that changed their name over the course of the study. So at the start of the study, I used the original Hans and Keck for their names for a term of the time. And then we also had to deal with the rejection names when it came out in 1993. So this is another wrinkle in this little question of plant names and things like that. I'm sure it's essential and all that kind of stuff. There's a pain in the neck for a simple field ecologist to try to come up with. An interesting one of ours is Stipa, Marcella, which is now changed back to Stipa again. I'm very interested in here. So I've kept all my fields data sheets in the old names in the hope that everything's going to change back to the new. I actually gave a talk about the 20-year data to the Jasper Ridge Docent group, and I used all the old names, and they applauded in the end because they were so I remember what the new name was for this year. Okay, so that's a brief summary of the 30-year data. We talked earlier about the needs for new young people, and new young people are needed because the old people are wearing out and so on. This is my new young person, and this is Lauren Mallett, who is my co-author, and I wanted to acknowledge her. She was a grad student with me in Western Australia and is now doing her doctorate at Clear Case at Berkeley. Lauren made a deal with the devil, or with me in fact, get her hands on the long-term data set to do stuff with, in return for saying that she would carry on with the long-term recordings once I came off the bird or see the plants anymore or whatever. The advantage of the new young person involved is that she actually knows how to use R and stuff like that. So she can run through a very complex R routine much faster than So Lauren and I are starting to get into the more complex analyses of these data sets. I just wanted to show you one quick vignette of what she's been doing. And that's where the title of the talk comes from. What I want to show you now is another time series, if you like, but mapping the abundance of Chromis molars or Chromis herniations, as it is, over the period of these plots. Again, just to give you a picture of the dynamics that's going on in these plots over that time. So, what we're going to see here is a map of Chromis abundance. Again, this is the 1983 plot. So these are the grids with the 50,000 centimeter quadrats of the overall abundance of Chromis in each. The darker it is, the more abundant it is, basically. So let's run through that quickly as well to give you a picture.
So we've got things like Pleistocene rewilding, where people
talked about the fact that, well, the Native Americans wiped out the mountains and things like that, so we should really be thinking about putting all those back in our systems. We can't do that, so what's the nearest thing to mount? Well, it's an African elephant, so let's bring African elephants so we could across the place. But you see the logic behind it. I have a problem with this, fast-moving stuff, because as we've been hearing, we have a very uncertain and tricky future ahead of us. And so as well as thinking about what was there before, we need to think about what should be there in the future and how we can equip our systems to deal with that. And so, we've got most of our management and global construction, if you fix the bad stuff that's going on, fixing reps and so on. But to me, we need to extend our management time horizon higher so that we're bringing into the picture of climate change stuff, sustainability and so on, thinking about these woolly concepts like resilience and what they actually mean and how to get about them. So, that to me is the kind of situation that restoration is at the moment. Trying to figure out what this expansion focus is all about, while at the same time trying to move towards the future. To me, the problem with all of this is that our level of understanding, which is at the bottom here, it's in some cases pretty high for what we've got now, but to me, I think it failed off very rapidly when we start looking at that. Some of our systems, we know their history and their paleo history quite well, but often we don't, or we think we do, but we don't actually know too much. A lot of our experience of what we think ecosystems are like is based on scanty notes from the early explorers or missions or whatever. And our level of understanding what's going to happen in the future tails off very dramatically too. So we're at this kind of nexus where we're dealing with two uncertain situations. So I was going to the famous philosophers. Focus on the things in boxes, so the trees and the layer and so on. From system dynamic stuff, from the elevators onwards, that showed to be often not the best thing to do, and there's many other aspects of the system that you can actually look at to do things better. You can look at what's supposed to be the transition, and you can look at feedbacks.
Yeah.
Okay. And in some cases, there's feedbacks which are keeping the state it's in. In other cases, there's feedbacks which are actually forcing the transition to go even faster. And it's recognized from many different types of systems analysis perspectives that if you can identify those problem loops are and deal with them, you're actually going to have a much bigger effect than just dealing with the things that are in the boxes. And the other thing is that that's just the biophysical aspect, and that's nested within the overall social system within which you work. And that system has a set of rules and paradigms and goals, which also influence what we're doing. So what the management agencies can do, what the policy says we can do, what's actually possible from a management perspective. And Donnell Meadows' work was to suggest that often it's better to try and intervene up here rather than slugging your guts out down here to make things happen. And if you can actually change some of the rules or even the paradigms, working on them, you can actually make a really dramatic change a lot more efficiently. So, so going back to some of the grasslands, I'm very grateful to Carol because she introduced this topic for me, and I don't need to go into too much detail about it. Now, one of the big threats to some of the grasslands in the Bay Area is the end deposition that we've heard about, power generation and so on. And that favors the invasive grasslands that leads to the kind of thatch that we talked about, the kind of species loss that's possible. And this is a picture similar to Carla's. And what it shows simply is that you can fence out nitrogen. It's very straightforward. And the conservation paradigm. type of work, if you could just put a fence around a piece of serpentine and leave it as it is, it's going to turn into a field of arena and everything else. So you actually need some kind of intervention. In this case, cattle seem to be okay with conservation. Maybe from the serpentine grasslands, more broadly out to California grasslands in general. It's interesting hearing about restoration attempts for these. In many cases, we don't actually know what the historic configuration of these grasslands were, grasslands were. There's lots of contention over how much growth, how much grass was in it, what mix of herbaceous, the forms versus the grassland, and so on. So it's hard to actually set a restoration target in many cases. But why do we value them in the first place? Often it's for a mix of them. Sometimes it's for biodiversity, and sometimes it's also because they're good forage catching. They sequester carbon, they stabilize soil and all sorts of things. So there's a range of different values that we want. So in this case, are we trying to restore their historic composition or focus on function and value? We've had this discussion earlier, and obviously some people are much more invested in the historical composition. In some cases, it would be possible to focus on that entirely. In other cases, and certainly we're in very large areas, we probably need to have a mixed situation where we're dealing with both. What seems to be happening is that there's an increasing degree of concordance about what good management in these grasslands is. If there's a mixture of native and annual grasses, like the type of old mix, it's good for forage, it's relatively diverse, then we can probably just leave that as it is. Where we've got situations though where there's every bunch of really nasty invaders coming in, like goldgrass and so on, nobody likes them, so they're not good for diversity, cows get eaten and so on. And so that's probably where it's a good place to try and intervene. So we can try and keep the grassland in a modified and certainly not historic state, but one that's not better than the alternative. So as someone pointed out, we're in a dynamic situation, so what we've got now isn't always going to stay as it is now. We're going to keep moving on. And it seems like the future for grasslands that are invaded by abusive animals is worse than what we've got now, so it's a good idea to try and get it over there. More generally, trying to figure out what we do with grasslands, there's a lot of discussion about this, and we have historical treatments. Laura Cunningham's a great book on the history of California. Wonderful pictures of what California was probably like in the past. And we also have approaches like using phytoliths or plant skeletons or something, trying to actually get some data for what was actually in these grasslands in the past. And we also know more now about what Native Americans did in these areas. And we're learning more about many of these areas were in fact managed for long periods of time. And this again sort of directs what we should be doing to try and integrate these areas. And the ongoing discussion about the various different types of grasslands and formal vegetation and life in California. Vinici's book where he suggested that maybe the paradigm that cut off quite a lot, that the bunch of grasses are everywhere, wasn't quite right, and that a lot of places were actually a lot more formal dominated. And also suggesting that maybe invasion by European species wasn't predicated by heavy grazing and so on, as many people have said. So the story great for the past really depends on which types of information we use. And what Vinici did was go back to the Spanish records from the early colonies, which hadn't been abroad. So trying to gather information from as many sources as possible so that we can actually build up a picture of what it was. And then decided that our own So we can take pictures of what it was like in the past, and we can aim for pretty and glamorous and aesthetically pleasing versions in the future. I hope we can successfully deal with the kinds of threats that far as possible. All the stuff we'll be talking about in terms of intervention and alternative restoration techniques make things less clear and less easy than they would be to just stuck to the standard restoration paradigm of trying to find a reference site and replicating it. I think that's okay, because I think the situation that we're in now, with rapidly changing environments, the urbanization, climate change, and so on, we actually need to think very carefully about what we're doing, and not just assume that a standard approach is going to fit every situation. So before we embark on restoration projects, so that we make sure that what we're doing is actually sensible and going to result in things that last in the future. From my perspective,
over time, it seemed like there was a reduction, a general reduction in the cars before. It's hard to tell with the timing of the pictures, but is that your impression of looking at that over time?
That's certainly the case. I mean, I started in 1982, 83, 84, and that was the El Nino years, were some of the wettest years we've had. And the Mastinia, those years were just spectacular. And I thought that's what the dress was like all the time. So I really got quite upset when it started to not be like that. And it's not been like that again over the next 30 years. We have had periods with Mastinia's increased in funding again.
Talk to all the speakers and ask them questions that you haven't been able to.